2063, Zefram Cochrane achieved his historic warp flight, an event which led to mankind's first contact with an alien species and launched a new age of peace and progress on planet Earth. But there was more to that event than history originally recorded. A year later, while giving a commencement speech at Princeton University, Cochrane made some cryptic remarks about what really happened during first contact. He spoke of cybernetic creatures from the future who tried to stop his warp flight, their ultimate goal being to enslave the human race. He claimed they were defeated by a group of humans, also from the future. No one took him seriously. A few years later, he recanted the whole thing. We now know that Dr. Cochrane's statements were not the imaginative rantings of an eccentric. We now know that the cybernetic creatures he spoke of were quite real and were members of perhaps the most patently malevolent and relentless force in the galaxy, the Borg.
In the words of Jean-Luc Picard, in their collective state, the Borg are utterly without mercy, driven by one will alone, the will to conquer. They are beyond redemption, beyond reason. And then there's Captain Amosov of the Endeavor. It is my opinion that the Borg are as close to pure evil as any race we've ever encountered.
The Borg is the ultimate user. They're unlike any threat your Federation has ever faced. They're not interested in political conquest, wealth, or power as you know it. They're simply interested in your ship, its technology. They've identified it as something they can consume.
The outer colonies were the first to fall. 23 in a matter of hours. Our sentry vessels tossed aside. No defense against the storm. And by the time they had surrounded our star system, hundreds of cubes, we had already surrendered to our own terror.
They invade our space, and we fall back. They assimilate entire worlds, and we fall back. Not again. The line must be drawn here! This far, no farther! I will make them pay for what they've done!
The Borg are a massive organization of beings abducted from other species, each genetically and cybernetically altered to serve the collective at large as drones. Being wholly robbed of any sense of individuality, the billions, perhaps trillions, of Borg drones operate as a hive mind. All thoughts are only those of the collective. The society is analogous to an insect colony with a queen at the apex of the hierarchy. The Borg have spread their influence into all four quadrants of the Milky Way and beyond, into nearby galactic clusters and even trans-dimensional realms in their pursuit of new technologies and resources, often destroying entire civilizations in their wake. They apparently originated in the Delta Quadrant thousands of years ago, but exactly how the Borg came to be and why they started their imperialistic mission of assimilation and their quest for perfection is a complete mystery.
We wish to improve ourselves. We will add your biological and technological distinctiveness to our own. Your culture will adapt to service ours.
The Borg never create. They only assimilate. When a vessel or planet catches the Borg's attention, they will sweep it with their senses, then transport drones over to investigate the technology up close. If they deem the vessel and its occupants worthy of assimilation, they will announce,
"We are the Borg. You will be assimilated. Resistance is futile."
They will then acquire the vessel by force and transform the occupants into drones, turning their bodies and minds entirely over to the collective and its purposes. Assimilation occurs in two basic steps. First, the individual is injected with nanoprobes, microscopic machines which attach themselves to the victim's blood cells and begin to immediately rewrite the victim's DNA. Second, cybernetic technology is implanted throughout the victim's body. This technology includes a neurotransceiver in the upper spinal column, which links every drone to the collective, and a neuroprocessor placed just below the ribcage to store all information and instructions received from the collective. Other standard surgical modifications include the replacement of one forearm with a functional prosthetic and one eye with a holographic imaging system. Once fully absorbed, the drone is supported by the technology. It no longer needs to eat, though it requires regular infusions of power, and it can function in environments normally harmful to organic life forms, such as the vacuum of space. The new Borg drone is then assigned a position in the hierarchy of the collective and given a designation reflecting that position.
2 of 9, primary adjunct of Unimatrix 01.
3 of 9, auxiliary processor of Unimatrix 01.
4 of 9, secondary adjunct of Unimatrix 01.
Borg vessels come in a small variety of geometrically symmetrical designs, embodying their monolithic mentality and their philosophy of perfection. The most common form is the cube. The Borg cube is the standard patrol vessel used by the collective to seek out new species and new technologies and assimilate them when desired. Typically occupied by tens of thousands of drones, this vessel has a highly decentralized design, with no specific bridge, engineering, or living areas. The ship can analyze an opponent's weapon systems and adapt defenses within seconds, and it is capable of repairing major damage, including direct phaser hits, almost immediately. The second most common form of Borg ship is the sphere, typically smaller than a cube and often with a specialized function such as reconnaissance. The sphere generally holds a small contingent of drones. The most highly specialized Borg ship is the one that holds the so-called lair of the Borg Queen. The Borg Queen vessel is also symmetrical in form, with a diamond shape that houses a spherical inner chamber. Normally docked within the enormous complex known as Unimatrix 1, this ship provides the Queen with a heavily shielded base from where she can choreograph the actions and thoughts of the entire collective. The Borg Queen herself is an enigma. The central locus of the collective, she brings order to the legions of voices within the hive mind, providing a common direction, and often speaks for the collective when such form of communication is deemed efficient. But she is a paradox.
Who are you?
I am the Borg.
That is a contradiction. The Borg have a collective consciousness. There are no individuals.
I am the beginning, the end, the one who is many. I am the Borg.
First officially documented Federation encounter with the Borg came in 2365, when the USS Enterprise-D was hurled 7,000 light-years across the galaxy by the entity known as Q, into the path of a cube. It was this encounter that established the Borg as a real and imminent threat. Starfleet immediately started planning a defense. The matter was made more urgent by evidence that the Borg had already violated Federation space and destroyed outposts along the Romulan neutral zone. Strategic simulation exercises were conducted, and a new class of heavily armed starship began development. But the preparations would prove too little, too late.
Dwarf, dispatch a subspace message to Admiral Hansen. We have engaged the Borg.
The Federation's worst fears came true just over a year later, when a Borg cube invaded Federation space on a direct course toward Sector 001, Earth. That incursion led to the historic Battle of Worf 359, one of the bloodiest conflicts in Starfleet history. An armada of 40 starships was annihilated by a single Borg cube, nearly 11,000 personnel lost.
Thank you.
catastrophe was a result largely of the assimilation of Captain Jean-Luc Picard.
I am Locutus of Borg. Your life, as it has been, is over. From this time forward, you will service us.
Fortunately, Picard's crew managed to recapture him and find a way to use his link to the Borg Collective to trigger a self-destruct command on the cube. But the plans of the Borg are not so easily vanquished. 6 years after Wolf 359, the Borg regrouped and launched a second offensive to assimilate Earth, but this time with a more subversive strategy.
This is Captain Picard of the Enterprise. I'm taking command of the fleet. Target all of your weapons onto the following coordinates.
Thanks to Jean-Luc Picard's experience with the Borg, the attacking cube was quickly extinguished by the Starfleet Armada. However, it managed to release a probe that sent itself into a temporal vortex aimed at the year 2063. Its mission? Destroy the Phoenix before Zephram Cochrane achieves his first warp flight. Prevent first contact with the Vulcans and the eventual formation of the Federation. Leave humanity vulnerable to assimilation by disempowering it in the past. Luckily, the Enterprise E followed the sphere in its temporal wake and foiled the Borg's plan while helping Dr. Cochrane recover from the attack and launch the Phoenix at the right moment to preserve history. Centuries later, the odd statements made by Dr. Cochrane in 2064 were explained. Humanity's dealings with the Borg were not confined to our own corner of the galaxy. The Federation starship USS Voyager, presumed destroyed in the Badlands in 2371, had actually been transported by an entity called the Caretaker into the far reaches of the Delta Quadrant, literally into the Borg's own backyard. 2 years into their journey toward home, Voyager arrived at the outskirts of Borg space, and for 5 years after that had continual dealings with the Borg.
Red alert.
Voyager could not avoid getting entangled in the Collective's brutal conflict with the powerful transdimensional beings called Species 8472. Armed with modified nanoprobe technology developed by the ship's emergency medical hologram, Captain Catherine Janeway decided to make a deal with the devil in exchange for safe passage across Borg space. Janeway offered the Collective assistance in their fight against the fluidic space creatures, leading to a bizarre alliance between human and Borg. The Borg went so far as to assign a formerly human drone to work in direct contact with the Voyager crew. This drone was known as Annika Hansen, but her Borg designation was
7 of 9, tertiary adjunct of Unimatrix 01.
Voyager's plan to fight back Species 8472 succeeded, but the crew never really believed the Borg would hold up their end of the bargain.
This alliance is terminated. Your ship and its crew will adapt to service us.
Bridge to Chakotay, Scorpion.
Initiating power surge now!
The result was a new crew member aboard the starship, Seven of Nine, as she preferred to be called, was severed from the collective and began the arduous process of regaining her humanity, both physically and psychologically. It was a most difficult personal journey for the woman who was assimilated at age 6 and spent her formative years as a drone, and several times she very nearly reverted back to the hive.
You will be assimilated. Resistance is futile.
When the Voyager crew attempted to appropriate a transwarp coil from a damaged scout ship, the Borg Queen took advantage of the situation and attempted to lure Seven of Nine to rejoin the collective, not by force, but voluntarily.
Don't be afraid. We won't turn you into a drone. You're much too valuable to us with your individuality intact. They've corrupted you. But the damage can be repaired.
But Seven resisted, asserting her individuality and her loyalty to her new collective, the Voyager crew. Voyager's history with the Borg in the Delta Quadrant could fill volumes, but it was one final run-in with the perennial foe that actually led to the starship's return home. A visitor from the future, an alternate timeline version of Catherine Janeway, approached the present-day Voyager with new technologies to help the starship defend itself against the Borg. Admiral Janeway and Captain Janeway teamed up to guide the ship to a Borg transwarp hub to use it as a shortcut home, while at the same time deal a crippling blow to the collective. Voyager traversed the transwarp network while deploying its new transphasic weapons to obliterate it. But when a sphere gave chase, Voyager employed a tricky maneuver that put it inside the Borg vessel. Once the sphere exited the transwarp conduit, Voyager destroyed the sphere from the inside, and the ship emerged before a Starfleet flotilla less than a light year from Earth. Meanwhile, Admiral Janeway stayed behind in the Delta Quadrant with a tricky maneuver of her own, letting herself be captured by her old nemesis, the Borg Queen. Fate of the Borg Queen and the collective as a whole is unknown, but it is presumed that Admiral Janeway's neurolytic pathogen resulted in significant, perhaps terminal, damage. But the Borg have proven time after time to be resilient, adaptive, and above all, persistent. Will we ever encounter the Borg again? Will they bounce back and continue to spread across the galaxy like a disease? Will we ever again face the terrifying specter of assimilation? Is resistance to the Borg ultimately futile?